I began my teaching career, it was a quarter century ago, and it was fresh off of the Rodney King assault and an innocent verdict. And we see today of all the things that we are dealing with and the continuation of state-sanctioned murder in our cities and all the other ways that anti-blackness and racism permeate society and our institutions. And so I firmly believe, just like a quarter century ago, was one of the reasons that the organizations that helped me become a teacher, they were nonprofits, they're HBCUs, Cheney University, and the School District of Philadelphia, that recruited black men to get into education, to become teachers. The issues that were happening in the streets and in communities, you know, looked at education as a part of it, and teachers as civic leaders that they are, being a part of the solution. And while teaching wasn't part of my original plan, you know, once I started, I never looked back. Originally, I wanted to be a lawyer. I looked at the courtroom as the place for me to really stand for justice and fight on behalf of my community. I knew I wanted to dive into activism, but I didn't necessarily look at education and teaching as activism. Now I know better. It is the best way to demonstrate activism in a sustained way, in a pervasive way. And I'm grateful to be there. What I knew 26 years ago was that I knew I wanted to be to have an impact on my community. And so when I met a black male educator, Dr. Martin Ryder, and he asked me, why didn't I consider teaching to be a part of that? I really didn't have an answer. I knew a lot of activists who were teachers, but no one had connected the dots. I was a beneficiary of many great teachers, particularly in my elementary and middle schools, but no one really engaged me directly about becoming a classroom teacher. And so Dr. Martin Ryder helped me to connect the dots between racial justice, social justice, and educational justice. And as he was helping me to connect these dots, you know, I realized that he was just watering and tending to the roots that my mother was a teacher, and my own teachers, what they had already established. And so Dr. Martin Ryder was really helping me to connect it in a very profound and deep way. As Dr. Simonette said, and Dr. King as well, you know, teaching is a revolutionary act. Teaching is something that shapes nations and communities. And it's one of the best ways to uplift the trajectory of our students. And we need people who are going into the classrooms to lead, not just looking at teaching as teaching content, but leading children, leading communities. And that's an imperative. And, you know, it's something that I understood after I started teaching. And what I recognize is great teachers don't just teach and impact the students in front of them. They impact those students' grandchildren and generations to come. The fellowship that Dr. King mentioned, the Fellowship of Black Male Educators for Social Justice, you'll see a picture of some of the brothers who formed that on your screen now. These were men who were interested in collectively joining a movement, ensuring that their leadership was connected and linked with other black men's leadership, and that we were able to stand up and not just be highly effective teachers, but also ensuring that we were standing for justice. Ensuring that the pressures and the racism and the biases that impact our students and our classrooms and our schools were addressed. One of the things that we used to do, and there was 17 black men who started this, this fellowship, was this idea of going to students and to speaking to them. And what we called it was a Why I Teach tour. Our brother Raymond Roy Pace came up with that term. And we would go around and speak to students about becoming teachers. And many of them would initially say, I'm not interested in teaching because of the experiences that I have as a student, as a black student in these schools. And so one, it speaks to the connectivity, like how we have to make sure that, yes, teaching, but also standing tall and strong and firmly against injustice and those things that make schooling and education a negative experience for so many Black children and children of color. But when we talk to them about connecting the dots, the same way that Dr. Martin Ryder did for me, between racial justice, social justice, and educational justice, when we shared with them ways that they could consider becoming a teacher that they wish they had and knew they needed, that seemed to resonate with them. Because it centered teaching as empowerment and community building. It celebrates agency and impact. And that's what I believe that our participants, whether you are on the road to teaching, considering teaching, or you're in the classroom or adjacent to a classroom already, I think that is an integral part of the work. You heard some data from Dr. King and that was published by John Hopkins and a collective of researchers who came up. And this is the same data that it corroborated what Black communities had been saying since the late 1800s, that Black teachers matter, that they matter for Black kids, they matter for all kids, that the understanding, having this windows and mirrors as a teacher, as a Black teacher, a Black student. The Black student typically has a window to everyone else's lives. They see other people's literature, other people's heroes and quotes plastered on the walls. There's someone who does not look like them who leads the classroom, leads the school, leads the school board. And white children, conversely, always have mirrors. They see themselves positively portrayed in the literature, in the curriculum, in those who are leading in the classroom. And so what we need are windows and mirrors to be exchanged, that Black children get to have more mirrors, get to see images of themselves leading classrooms, leading schools, leading school boards. And white children need to have more diversity in their curriculum and what they intake and what they breathe in. We know that anti-Blackness has a long history. And we can't be naive to think that it does not show up in our curricula, it does not show up in our schools. And we need people, we need vanguards, we need activists who will be in our classrooms, in our schools, supporting all our students, ensuring that educational justice is realized. You know, last year was my 26th year and the last year that I worked in a school and really wanted to pay it forward in a big way, and this, which is why I launched the Center for Black Educator Development, to really look at and advocate for policies that support more Black teachers, to uplift Black pedagogy, the way that Black teachers have taught for centuries and have been really effective. And I'm so glad Dr. King brought up Dr. Gloria Ladson-Billing, who really, you know, coined that term, culturally relevant teaching. And so many people, including myself and our organization, were building on her legacy and trying to expand the work that she launched many years ago. And so our work continues to be professional learning and mentoring and coaching, as well as providing apprenticeships for high school and college students who are interested in teaching. And so we are, I'm grateful to be a part of this forum, to be able to learn and contribute right alongside of you all. But I'm hopeful that you all will continue to build community, even during, if it's virtually, to please continue to build community. Often teachers are in a room and then that becomes a silo. It does not have to be, it should not be. Know that you have a community in all of us who are on this call and beyond. So thank you.